is a life-changing message by the Reverend Sam Korankye Ankrah.
We'll continue our teachings on the season of the double. And we are looking at Elisha's miracles and how they relate to us in our contemporary situations. Elisha's miracles. I have done about two already. Today is the third one. I have done Bring Me Back My Axe. And then on Mother's Day, I did Go Sell the Oil and Pay Your Debt. Today, I will do the one which I have titled Disarming Your Enemies. Disarming Your Enemies. And take note, I didn't say disarming the enemy. So I'm not looking at Satan as enemy. I'm looking at your numerous enemies, including people, including situations, including sicknesses, including situations. They are all enemies, but we shall disarm all of them. And I am looking at the Elisha miracle in 2 Kings chapter 6, verses number 15 to 21. 2 Kings chapter number 6, verse number 15. Now, this was when the Assyrians had oppressed the Israelites for so long. They have intimidated them, they have cowed them, and the Israelites were virtually scared because Assyrians were controlling the palace of Israel, the palace in Samaria, everything. Israel has been trying to oppose the rulership over them and the control. And the Assyrians had been planning to invade Israel and finish Israel once and for all. Ladies and gentlemen, sons and daughters, anytime they gathered to plan a strategy, some way the prophet Elisha in Samaria, Israel, will pick a revelation and will warn the king of Israel and say, the people are coming for an invasion. They will be coming through this route and at this time. And then the Israelites will gather themselves and foil the attack. It happened once, twice, thrice. And then the king of Assyria said, there is somebody in our midst who has been going to reveal our strategies to the Israelites. Let's look for this person and deal with him. So they said to him, sir, there is no enemy here. There is a prophet in Israel. He's called Elisha. He is the one. Anytime we plan something, he picks it up and then he reveals. That's why we are always frustrated. So the king then sent soldiers to Samaria to go and arrest Elisha. So then I pick my story from verse number 15. And when the servant of Elisha, the man of God, arose early in the morning and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, Elisha, alas, my master, what shall we do? We have been surrounded by the enemies. So Elisha then answered, do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Those who are with you are more and more powerful and stronger than those who are against you. Can you clap your hands? If you don't understand, just shout amen. Amen. You understand later on. Verse number 17. Then Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see. Today, the Lord will open somebody's eyes. Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. You are protected and you are preserved from evil men. And whatever wicked people are planning, we disarm them by the power of God. Can you clap your hands and say, in the name of Jesus, wherever they are, and whatever plans they have, I don't need to know, but I disarm them. Clap your hands and shout yes. This prayer prayers are very necessary. Because if you pray this prayer and some people are looking for you to lynch you, at least it will help you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You don't need to know anything. Just pray. And be free. So when the Syrians came down to him, then Elisha prayed to the Lord and said, strike these people, I pray, with blindness. And he struck them with blindness according to the word of Elisha. 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 This week, all night, camp meeting. When I ask you to pray, stand there and be watching people who are praying. Now Elisha said to them. So the story is, it's funny. So Elisha struck them with blindness. Then Elisha went to them when they were blind. And then he asked them, who are you looking for? Then they said, we are looking for Elisha. The king said, we should come and arrest Elisha. Elisha was talking to them. Elisha said, follow me. I'm going to show you where Elisha is. Then Elisha led them to the palace of the king of Samaria. When the king of Samaria saw his enemies, he said, Elisha, how did you bring people here? Then he commanded, bring me sword. Today we will kill these people. Elisha said, no, don't kill them. Give them food to eat. They said, what? I said, give them food. After they ate, Elisha prayed for them and said, let their eyes open. When their eyes open, then the people said, ha! We are in the hands of the enemy. Elisha said, we won't touch you. Go back and tell your king that when you came, mission was impossible. From today, may you not cross the line again and come and harass us. Today, we put the demarcation between us and the enemy. Clap your hands and say, devil, you will not cross this line and come after me, my education, my career, my future, my children. I forbid you. Clap your hands and say, shame unto the devil. He said, go and tell the king who sent you that we could have killed all of you, but today we spare you. Go. And that will be enough. There are three situations in your life that you must hate and you must fight. The first one, when there is a perpetual situation of failures in your life, perpetual successions of failures, is a situation you must not harbor. You should not be happy. You should contend with it. You should deal with it. Reason. When there is constant failures in your life, there comes a time when you start hearing the voice that tells you, that's it. You can't make it anymore. You are born to fail, and you are going to fail because so-and-so fail. You have tried. You have gone to church. You have done everything. You have fasted. It's not working. And the devil says that, yeah, that's your portion. That's your calling. That's your destination. The devil is a liar. Clap your hands and say, devil, you a liar. So say, devil, I'm not staying in that situation. I won't stay in that situation. So when you have this situation of constant failure, you are failing one examination after examination, you are failing one interview after interview, nothing you do works for you, I want you to know that it is an intimidating situation. You have to resist it. And I'm going to help you resist it. Here is the second situation that you must not entertain. A situation of lack and perpetual and continuous poverty. Don't entertain that situation. It's okay if you are poor now. It's okay if you lack now. For now, it's okay. It's a season. But tell yourself that season must pass. That season must be over. That season will leave you. One day, another thing must happen. Another season of sufficiency. You must be a married man, married woman, providing for your children, paying their school fees. Tell yourself. Oh, I'm coming. By the time I'm done with you, you will know that these things are possible. I am not interested in the first two. I'm interested in the last one because that's my text. The last one, the situation of continuous fear, intimidation, and control from people who are bigger and have more than whatever. A situation of fear and intimidation. And weakness. It's a situation you must resist. a situation of continuous intimidation, continuous weakness, and continuous fear. In other words, somebody rises in your office, your home, your house, your area, a friend, and they cow you. They intimidate you so much because they have money. They intimidate you so much because they have something you don't have. They intimidate you so much because they have a better background. And you know how you can be scared, you can be afraid. Please resist that. Because that's the core of Elisha's the miracle. The Israelites had been cowed too much. They had been intimidated too much. Elisha said, look, enough is enough. We won't allow you anymore. Lord, strike them with blindness. By the time I'm done with you today, I want to build a certain confidence in you. Respect people, but don't fear people. Respect people who are successful, but don't be intimidated by their success. Don't be intimidated. Because anything you fear, you will never achieve. Are you understanding what I am saying? I'm talking to a young girl over here. You are beautiful. The Lord says I should tell you are beautiful. But somebody intimidates you so much. You are not beautiful. They drop you. Every day he's threatening you. I will leave you. I'll go for another girl. I'll leave you. I'll go for another girl. And you stand in the mirror and you think that other girls are more beautiful. Oh, leave that fool. You are beautiful. Today, anything that makes you so weak, I get you out of it. May the Lord strengthen your faith. May you not be intimidated. May you not be, respect people, but don't fear people. Can I hear somebody say amen? Can I hear somebody say amen? I am bringing you to the place where you know that Christ in you is the hope of your glory. And that is just a matter of time. That thing which they have, that makes them so pompous. You get it, you get it more. Clap your hands and say, in the name of Jesus, I will not be intimidated anymore. I will not be afraid. I will not be afraid. Clap your hands and shout, yes. I'm not afraid of the problem. Who shall I fear
if God be for me?
What shall we say?
What shall we say to these things?
What shall we say to these things? Come on now.
What shall we say to these things?
Scream it. Let the devil hear you. I'm not afraid anymore.
I'm not afraid anymore. I'm not afraid anymore.
You see, when people discover that you fear them, and because you fear them because of threat and because of things that, you know, they say and so on, you know, you give them the power to continue. Oh yeah, because by human nature, every human being wants to control. May you not be intimidated and be afraid from today. How did Elisha make it? How did Elisha get out of that intimidation and that fear? How did he overcome that? Three things. Number one, you must know who is working for you. You must know who is on your side. You must know who is on your side. You must know who is working for you. Number two, you must know what is in your mouth. You must know what is in your mouth. Number three, you must know what you carry. Number three, you must know what you carry. Number one, know who is for you. Know who is on your side. Know who is working for you. Know who is fighting for you. Number two, know what is in your mouth. You must know what is in your mouth. Number three, you must know what you carry. I will start from the bottom. Know what you carry. Every child of God, you are carrying some anointing and some power that helps you to disarm the enemy. You are not empty. Every child of God, you are carrying something. And now watch me. The fact that you do not see what you are carrying does not mean that you are not carrying anything. At the time Elisha was ministering to the young man hadn't seen anything until Elisha prayed and opened his eyes and he saw horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. He said, so this is what is happening in the realms of the spirit, and I didn't know. And And he was so afraid and scared. He had come to Elisha. Elisha, the people have surrounded us. So what you don't see does not mean that it is not there. I'm coming home. The fact that you don't have money right now does not mean that you are poor. You still can't get me. Let me try there. The fact that you don't have money now does not mean that you are poor. If the Lord opens your eyes right now and the Lord shows you what you become 10 years from now, you stop crying and you stop misbehaving, you stop fooling. Are you married?
No.
So how old are you?
24.
The man who will marry you, how old will he be? Do you want him to be? Must he be? What is your choice? How old would your husband be?
29.
You want 29? So somebody who is about 5 years older. Okay. I thought you were going to say you want a 3-year-old man. You want somebody who's 29. So it means that the person you are looking for is already born. He's somewhere. You are 24. He's 29. Somewhere. He's also looking for you. So the fact that you don't have a husband does not mean that your husband is not there. Your husband is born. May you collide into your miracle. You didn't hear what I said. May you collide into your miracle. Your husband is already looking for you. The miracle you are looking is already looking for you. The money you are looking for is already looking for you. Clap your hands and shout in the name of Jesus. Lord, open my eyes that I will see what I have. Clap your hands and celebrate, young people. Praise the name of the Lord. What you are looking for is already looking for you. You are carrying something. You are carrying beauty. You are carrying wisdom. Despite what people say. And if you don't see, it doesn't mean it is not there. When I met Mama Rita, so funny, I met her in the Volta region. I was going to preach. I was a young student from Accra High School, sixth form. And I was going to preach. You didn't hear myself. I was going to preach. I carried Bible, but in the preaching, then I collided with the woman who became my wife in the last 31 years. May the Lord order your steps into your miracle. I'm prophesying like 20 years ago. May the Lord order your steps into your miracle. Clap your hands and shout, I receive. Shout it again and say, I receive it. You don't have money. Yes, you are not poor. It's just a matter of time. Can you imagine when I went proposing to Mama Rita, and then Mama Rita looked at me and said, do you have a house? No. Do you have a passport? No. Do you have any visas in your passport? No. Do you have a car? If I had a car, I would be walking to your house to come and propose to you. If all the questions she asks, no, 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 no. And then she says, I'm sorry, but I'm too beautiful for my life to be wasted. Oh, those of you came new, you haven't heard the story. She used to have a boyfriend who is called Felix Ankrah. Yes. You think life is... life is... You see, God has prophesied that she will marry an Ankrah. And so the devil brought a counterfeit Ankrah. Felix. He was darker, I am fairer. So the devil is a bad boy. Then she met another Ankrah who is born again. Then I introduced Christ and she loved my Jesus. After I have brought her into Christ, then I said, can you come into my life also? Then I could hear her say, oh, again, from Ankrah to Ankrah. And the Ankrah, the other Ankrah was alcoholic Ankrah. Appetitive, number one. There was the possibility of she getting scared, you know. Hey, this Ankrah, even though he's born again, is carrying the word of God. We have seen people who carry the word of God, but in the end they fail. You understand? We have seen people who preach, but they are poor. We have seen people who preach, but they beat their wives. We have seen people who preach, but they don't pay their children's school fees. As I stand here, some of the school fees that are paid, they are sons and daughters of pastors. So, from Apatasi Ankrah to Krife Ankrah does not really give any assurance. Common denominator. But when the first Adam fails, the second Adam will not fail. The second Adam will bring salvation and glory. May the Lord give you a second chance. Clap your hands and shout, yes!
Your name is Yahweh. Your name is Yahweh. You are the miracle working God. Your name is Yahweh.
Say it again.
Your name is Yahweh.
Your name is Yahweh.
You are the miracle working God.
You are the miracle working God.
Your name is Yahweh.
Say
it.
May the Lord give you another
miracle worker. Come and do a miracle, miracle today. Come and do a miracle.
Those of you who are coming, please keep coming. Please keep coming. Do you know that the first Ankrah died out of alcoholism at the age of 32? Yeah. Later on, we tried to bring him to Christ. But he was so hooked up, he didn't make it. Now the second Ankrah is alive, giving her 4 children, giving her ministry, giving her joy, comfort, brought the gift of God out of her life. Yahweh,
your name is Yahweh.
You are the miracle worker.
You are the miracle worker. Your name is Yahweh.
Your name is Yahweh.
Your name is Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Miracle worker.
You are the miracle worker.
Miracle worker.
Your name is Yahweh.
Clap your hands and say, devil in the name of Jesus.
Devil in the name of Jesus.
If you are trying to direct my course.
You are trying to direct my course.
And my path.
And my path
to destruction.
To destruction.
You will never succeed.
You will never succeed.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
You will succeed.
You will not succeed.
Hallelujah. You look, you are carrying something. Don't mind those who, oh, Jesus Christ. Your enemy's future is in your hands. You see, I kept telling you are carrying something. You are carrying something. You are carrying something. You don't know. What you are carrying is so dangerous, it can determine the future of your enemies. Elisha went to them after striking them with blindness. Then he went and asked them, are you looking for Elisha? They said, yes. Elisha said, follow me. I'm taking you to Elisha. Elisha took them to the king's palace and gave them food. After that, he prayed for them. He said, may your eyes open again. And they are open. He said, now go back and tell the one who sent you that these people, you don't mess up with them. Because if you mess up with us, you will regret it the days of your life. Are you hearing what I'm saying? At that moment, the man they were looking for, their lives were now in his hands. Elisha could determine whatever he wanted to do with them. That's who you are. That's who you are. You see, from today, don't fear them. When somebody is worrying you, look into the person's face. I give you that boldness. Look into their face and say, look, I don't want to open my mouth, because if I open my mouth, you and your household. Yeah, give the Lord a mighty shout. From today, you can determine and decide who should be pregnant, who should not be pregnant. That's who you are. That's who you are. When you buy a property and a land, you can decide who comes close to you and who must not come close to you. Let me do the second one. You must know what is in your mouth. Romans chapter number 10, verses number 8 to 10. You must know what is in your mouth. You must know what is in your mouth. Let me do that quickly, and then I'll do the last one. Romans chapter 8. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth. Do me King James. The King James is better than. But what saith the word? Now, Apostle Paul is quoting from the Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 34. And he says, what saith? That the word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. Verse 9. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. And then verse 10 announces a spiritual principle which will never change. Here is the principle. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now, Apostle Paul is teaching how you can become born again. You've been hearing the word born again, you don't know how. How you can become a saved person. Now, the principles are two. Number one, believe in your heart. Believe in your heart. What should you believe? Believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. God sent him to come and die for our sins. He died and rose again. His blood was shed so that you will be brought from darkness and your sins into Christ. What sins is he talking about? He's talking about the original Adamic sin into which you were born as a human being. That's what he's talking about. And so once you believe in your heart that Jesus Christ died for that sins, then the second principle, you then confess with your mouth. Confess with your mouth. Confess with your mouth that Jesus, you are Lord, come into my heart. Once you make that confession, you have been saved. If you haven't done this one, you are not born again. You have to do it today. So, what then becomes of the sins you've been committing every day, which is the sin of fornication, the sin of lying, and the sin of, you know, that is why anytime they make altar call, you are coming forward. You make altar call, you are coming forward because of the sins. No, that's your salvation does not is not canceled by those sins you've been committing. Take it from me. I'll say it again. Your sin of lying, your sin of fornication, your sin of stealing does not cancel your salvation which came to you by the application of these two principles. One, you believe. Two, you made a confession. You are saved. So what then happens to the sins you'll be committing every day? They are weaknesses which you have to fight and deal with. Because if you don't fight and deal with them, they can prevent you from going to heaven. And you cannot win over them one day. It takes years. Fall, you rise. You fall, you rise. Continue. One day you rise forever. Amen. Can you clap your hands and say, I'm saved? And say, I'm saved. So, take the salvation and then let's look at if we are looking for something. You apply the same principle. So, you are looking for healing. Believe in your heart that God is the healer. Confess with your mouth that he has healed you. Confess it. That's it. And you shall be healed. The same principle. Now, take the salvation. Take healing from there. And now you want to prosper. Money. you want to become wealthy tomorrow. Believe in your heart that God can make it, can make you, and then confess it. You will get it. These two principles work in every transformational theory or process in your life. From poverty to wealth, from sickness to health. Joel chapter 3 verse 10. It says, let the weak say, I am strong. It didn't say, let the strong say, let the weak. In other words, you call for strength in your weakness. So take weakness and bring poverty. Let the poor say, yeah. You don't make that confession when you are rich. You make it when you are poor. Let the failing student say, yes. Yes. For as a man believeth in his heart, so he says, with the mouth confession is made. With your mouth. With your mouth. With your tongue. Know what is in your mouth. Elisha, it was so easy for Elisha. Elisha said, Lord, make them blind. And they were blind. And you are looking, and he said, oh, please, you have that anointing. You have that anointing. You are not using it. You are not using it. The reason why nothing is happening to you into your life is that you talk negatively, you confess negatively. That is why I'm taking you to Legon under the theme, change your language. By the time I finish with you, your language will change. When you are weak, you say, I am strong. When you are poor, you say, I am well. When things are going bad, you say, it is well. You say it and 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 say it. Don't stop until you see manifestations. I changed my language. I like talking to students. Let's reason. When you take daily graphic and you read, what do you read? You read what? You read what? You read English. You read letters. Words. When you take Bible, what do you read? Letters. English. But you know that the information in the Bible is different from the one in the newspaper, even though they are all English. You see there, over there, you see there, over there. You see me there, you see me here. You see going there, you see going. They are all English words. But when you put them together, the one in the Bible gives you a different understanding, different from the one in the newspapers. So in other words, English and words alone don't mean anything. It is how you construct the sentence and what you want to say. I change. In other words, from today, I will not take any nonsense from you. But what's the ref saying? Once in the world, you are in Ghana, you have to say what everybody is saying. Ghana, you know, you see my Ghana is hard. They say we should not say it. There's no money. And they are asking that every day we come to church and give offering. Oh, please. You are speaking language. But the language you are speaking is not biblical language. You are speaking daily graphic language. Clap your hands and say, from today, I will speak Bible language because there is something in my mouth that I have to declare. Let the weak say, let the poor say, let the sick say, let the fearful say, let the failing student say. Lord, make them blind. Serious. Period. The people were blind. Lord, open their eyes. I said, hey, Charlie, you have such anointing that you can determine what happens to your enemies. When people are stepping on my toes and they are DJing me, I just look at them and say, this guy is just tempting me to open my mouth. But I'm a man of God. I will not open my mouth. Because if I open my mouth, from today, I give you that boldness. Don't disrespect people. Don't insult them. Don't curse them when they curse you. Just look at their faces and say, you know what? I have decided not to talk. Because if I decide to invoke my altar against you, but for God's sake and for the sake of righteousness, I just want to let go and just walk away. I don't want to hear that you are quarreling with unbelievers. I don't want to hear you. You are too special. You are carrying something unique that you must not put on the ground for people to trample upon. You are too important. You are too important. Know what you are carrying. Know what is in your mouth. What is in your mouth? Here's the last one. Know who is for you. Know who is around you. Elisha said, Lord, open his eyes. And when the Lord opened the eyes of his servant, he said, chariots and horses of fire. Hey, around Elisha. And I am so afraid like this. If only God will open your eyes. Now, chariots of fire. Before God opened his eyes to see the Syrian army was surrounded, the horses and the chariots of fire were already there. Only that he didn't see. Let me come home. Before your battle started, God is already fighting for you. In case you want to talk to me after church, I have answered your problem already. You better clap your hands and say, I receive it. Can I say that again? In case you want to talk to me, you don't need to come and waste your time. I said, if before your problem started, God was already fighting for you. You just must open your eyes and see the horses and chariots of fire. And chariots of fire, that reminds me of the Egyptian chariots. 600 of them, they came after the Israelites, chased them into the Red Sea. God told Moses, lift up your rod, stretch it over the sea. He did. And then the sea parted. And then they walked through. And then the chariots of chariots of Pharaoh were following them. And Moses closed the river and swallowed all of them and they sank. Wickedness? No. You are disarming your enemies. Because if you didn't swallow them, they would chase them. Anyone who wants to make life miserable, may the Lord swallow all of them in the sea. I haven't mentioned anybody's name. I haven't mentioned the way you are looking at me. I'm just prophesying. And I'm saying that those who have decided to hate you, those who have decided to frustrate you, I don't know who they are. I'm just speaking. By fire and by thunder, Lord, strike! Disarm them! Disarm them! Take away their powers and their authority. When they send us to juju, let their juju backfire upon. When they send you to the shrine, let the shrine backfire upon them. Clap your hands and shout, Jesus! I can't hear you, young people. Say, Jesus. You haven't seen anything before. Say, Jesus. Clap your hands and shout in the name of Jesus. My God and my Lord, do not fulfill their desires. Every horse, every chariot that is after my life, swallow them by the horses of fire and the chariots of fire. Swallow them. Swallow them. Prevail. Overcome. In the name of Jesus. Clap your hands and shout three times. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
The Syrian army came with horses and chariots. But when the Lord opened the eyes of Gehazi, The Elisha's servant, he saw chariots of horses and fire. Now, I'm not preaching on chariots. Otherwise, I will just refer you to the Joseph chariot. The Joseph chariot is a chariot of honor. When Pharaoh honored him, they gave him chariot and rode before him. I don't want to talk to you about Mordecai's chariot. When Mordecai was promoted, they gave him a chariot and then somebody rode before him and then they announced him and they proclaimed him. I don't want to talk to you about Elijah's chariot, because Elijah's chariot was the one that gave him lift to heaven. What an honorable ride to heaven. Yeah, the revelation. The revelation is that the fact that you have never seen the chariots that have surrounded you does not mean that there are no chariots surrounding you. Because you've seen the chariots of Assyria. You are so scared. You are so afraid. Today, every intimidation and fear must die in your life. There are chariots. There's a chariot of honor. It's coming. There's a chariot of promotion. It's coming. There's a chariot of grace. It's coming. There's a chariot of elevation. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. Kojo is coming. Sia, it is coming. Pastor Tony is coming. Felix is coming. Woman of God is coming. It's coming. Keith Foley is coming. David is coming. All my sons, I said there is a chariot of honor. The fact that you don't see does not mean that it is not there. It's just a matter of time. Matter of time. I am bringing the presentation to a close. Now, the last minute of everything is very interesting. So, give me all your attention. Who is fighting for you? Who is working for you? Who is on your side that you do not know? Elisha said, Lord, open his eyes. When you open his eyes and he sees those who are for us, his heart will rest. Lord, open his eyes. And he will see those who are on his side. So now let me bring you home. There are three things that people love to fight you over, because they are precisely the things that bring you the presence of God. And they are the things which determine that God is with you. Believe me, I'm going to blow you and I'm going to give you scriptures. But let me say the statement again. There are three habitual things that you have to learn to do. Those three things, when they become part and parcel of you, and they become an attitudinal character that you hold and cherish and keep, you are gone. Those three attitudinal characters, people fight and mock you to take away from you, because the devil knows what it brings to you. The first one, going to church. It's an attitude you must develop. And by the time I finish with you, I'll be surprised if you miss a church on a Sunday, or you miss Convention of Saints, you can choose to miss a day, or Week of the Altar, you can miss, or Tuesday, Friday service. If you are not going to school, you are just in the house watching TV. Hey, after this message, your attitude is changed. Going to church, number one. Number two, the second attitude that people fight you and mock you: your worship, praise, and prayer. Because they know what those things do. Prayer, praise, and worship. And the last one is giving and sacrifices. The reason why the devil makes it difficult for you to sacrifice and always make you hard up with money, and you steal God's tithe, and when you choose to go and buy airtime instead of giving your money to God or sacrificing, because you hear people saying to you, pastors are thieves, pastors are taking money. Oh yes, there are other pastors who are thieves, but not this one standing here. That thing over there, do you know how much it is? When we go to Gambaga and return, you know how much it is? The The generators, those huge generators over there that we put in oil, when lights go off, you don't even worry, you don't even care, because you know that within 1 minute, light is going to come. Go and see. In other churches, when lights go off, they turn the prayer, they start prayer. Ladies and gentlemen, the devil is interrupting our service. Shall we pray that light will come? They have bound the devil every day, lights light off. You light off has nothing to do with the devil. It is lack of money. Because you are banning, who are you banning? Electricity Company of Ghana or Akosombo? Who are you banning? Now the scripture. 1 Kings chapter 8, verse number 33. 1 Kings chapter 8. So Solomon had finished the temple, and it was dedication. And I here are the principles of the dedication. Watch. The dedication was started with sacrifices. They pour sacrifice on the altar. Hey, animals be what? Blood be what? Kayebo sakaria. Then the musicians raise song, worship, praise, prayer. Then the Bible says the glory of the Lord came down. Come on now. The priest could not preach. And I saw King Solomon with his kingly robe. He knelt down and he began to pray. He prayed several prayers. I'm picking only two of them. When your people Israel are defeated before an enemy because they have sinned against you, and when they turn back to you and confess your name and pray and make supplication to you in this temple. In this temple. But Pastor, we can pray everywhere. Oh, yes, we can pray everywhere. When you pray in your room, God is there. God will hear you. When you pray in trotro, God will hear you. When you pray in taxi, God will hear you. But those prayers in those places cannot be compared with the prayer that is prayed in the dedicated temple. In this temple. Then he says, verse number 34, when they pray in this temple, then hear in heaven and forgive the sin of your people Israel and bring them back to the land which you gave to their fathers. Another prayer, 35, when the heavens are shut up and there is no rain because they have sinned against you, when they pray toward this place, towards this place that I am standing, this place that I am dedicating, and confess your name and turn from their sin because you afflict them, verse 36, then hear in heaven and forgive the sin of your servants, your people Israel, that you may teach them the good way in which they should walk, and send the rain on your land, which you have given to your people as an inheritance. I want somebody who, if you can go and look for 2000 November when we came here, the prayers that I prayed over this altar, if you can get the tape for me, I'll be very, 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 very happy. Those of you, we are taking old tapes, 1997, and some old tapes. When you bring the old tapes to us, we shall duplicate them and return your old tape to you. And in addition, we shall give you a new tape that we have preached recently that you haven't bought. Is that okay? I just want to hear the things that I said, because the things that happen on this altar are too dangerous. Once I cannot remember the things that I said here, let me tell you the things that I did at the oil dome. So on the day of the breaking of the grounds of the oil dome, I took anointing oil. Then I anointed all the four corners of the land. I didn't know why God made me do, but that's what I do anytime I'm dedicating buildings. I try to cover all the corners so that the enemy cannot penetrate. Only for us, when we started the work, people scaled through the wall to come and start fighting with us that the land belonged to them. We have overcome that. How we did it, I don't know. But the Spirit of the Lord fought for us. Because at the time I was invoking, there were horses and chariots of fire fighting for us. Who is on your side? Who is fighting for you? That is not the end. Then they told me that to get permit to build this gigantic building in the city of Accra, we will not get it. Because they will ask us for fire this one. We should show them parking. This the crowd here will be too much. We'll cause traffic jam on the road. We'll have to need more police. We have to need this, so they won't give it to us. Ladies and gentlemen, the blood went ahead. The spirit went ahead. We got the permit. And that is not enough. Then finally, when we're going to break the ground, I came here in the night. When I came here with 7 bottles of anointing oil. I dug the ground myself alone. Then I invoked and I prayed. And I buried the anointing oil on the ground. Number 2. Then I brought tokens and communion elements. The blood and the bread. And then I dug the ground and I poured the blood in the ground and I covered it. Now, why did I use the body of Christ? I wanted 3 spiritual elements. The word, the spirit, and the blood. I could get the blood in the communion. I could get the spirit in the anointing. But I didn't want to bury physical Bible. Because physical Bible must be read by somebody. When you start burying physical Bible, then it's occultism. So I wanted something that stands for the word of God. And then the Lord reminded me that the bread is a symbol of the word. Oh, come unto me, you who are hungry, come and buy the bread free. Why do you spend money on that which does not satisfy? Isaiah chapter 54. So I used the bread as symbol of the word and I planted. So on that ground over there, there is word, there is spirit, and there is blood. Show me who can fight us in that place. All right, let's go up. Let's go up. You've heard about what is called haunted houses. Haunted houses. Haunted houses. What are haunted houses? Haunted houses are houses that people cannot live in peacefully. When you live in a haunted house, you have sleepless nights, you have nightmares. In the night, you can feel somebody walking in the ceiling. You can feel noise. You can hear the window open. Boom. You go and find, and there's nobody there. Haunted houses are houses that are beautiful, but people cannot live in peacefully. Now, the sources of the spirits, they apply the principle of invocation to an altar and to a temple. The day I came here, we came here, and then I invoked God's presence, this altar became a place of assemble of spirits and battles. That's why when you come here barren, there is a certain anointing here that fights the spirit. When you come here sick, there is a certain anointing that fights that sickness. When you come here poor, there is a certain anointing. But Solomon said, Lord, when they stand in this temple and they pray, they hear them. You can pray anywhere God can hear you, but in the temple, because there is a covenant of invocation and some spiritual activities happen. Oh, I'm coming. I'll take you to the oil dome very soon. What? The sources of the spiritual attacks in haunted houses. Number 1, when a house is built on an old cemetery, that house is likely to be haunted. So when you are going to buy a land, make sure that you check the history of the land. If it's an old cemetery, you need to do some breakings. Why is it very difficult to build on an old cemetery ground? Because on that ground, there is some blood that is innocent. Some people who were buried there shouldn't have been buried. They were killed innocently. So their blood is fighting. So anybody who go and build there, they will fight you. Which is now I can talk to the nation about the Denchira people, where Maxwell Adam Mahama died. You see, because the blood of an innocent man has been shed, his blood will fight the land. He'll fight the land. His blood will fight. I mean, this is just the word of God. I haven't picked the prophecy from anywhere. I'm telling you the word. Oh, you want a scripture? Yeah. When Cain shed the blood of Abel, the innocent blood, the blood did not make Cain have rest. The blood of Abel was speaking and was petitioning heaven until God heard and said, Cain, why did you shed that innocent blood? You are cursed with a curse. So every cemetery has people who have died naturally, but people who have also been killed innocently. And their blood will fight anybody who comes to build over there. Haunted houses. Another second source of a haunted house is when they used money from an innocent blood to build. They killed somebody and sold the parts. And the money, they used the money to build. That person's spirit will fight that house. And the third source of haunted houses is when the house was dedicated to ritualism and rituals and occultism and satanic practices. Once they have finished, a spirit has come to dwell in the house. Whoever stays in that house, they will fight you. That is why it is good to know the history of a house before you rent. In case you don't know the history, you can watch out for these things. When you discover that entering into that house, things have never worked for you, and make sure that when your advance is finished, don't go and renew it. The person built the house and put something under it. And the moment you invoke that covenant, the place becomes a battleground for spirits. So, I have prepared the grounds for this one. The day I carry you there, I would then, Jesus Christ, we are going to go there in prayer, in worship, in sacrifices. And I will make some invocations and declarations that will become a hallmark, a permanent stay. The Bible says, you see where the Solomon prayed right now? When you go to Israel right now, it's not a church which is there. It's a mosque. I hear virtually everything that Solomon spoke on that ground. The people who enter into that mosque, they are getting that miracle. And there's no church. I hear one of the pastors who went to Israel was telling me, he was so excited when they said they were going to Solomon's temple. He said, Jesus Christ, I will kneel down and I will pray. I will invoke all. He had taken First Kings chapter 8. He was going to invoke. I just invoked two of the prayers. Solomon asked God if it was 16 things. He was going to invoke all the 16. So when he got there, he was going, and then the security called him and said, are you a Christian or a Muslim? He said, I'm a Christian. He said, okay, that place is mosque. It's only Muslims go there. The Christians go to the other one. He said, but the other one is also, he said, we had to build another one to just resemble this one. I said, Jesus Christ, I want the original. Everything he prayed. Because the day he spoke, God just came down and God entered into the altar. And God made that place his house. That is why we ask you to dedicate your child. Because when you dedicate your child, God's spirit comes to possess your child. That's why we ask you to dedicate your house. When you dedicate your house, any house that you're going to live in after dedication, God comes to indwell the house, possess the house. That's why we ask you to dedicate your marriage. When you dedicate your marriage, God then comes to indwell your marriage, possess your marriage. That is why we ask you, anything that you buy, watch, phone, dedicate it to God. How effective is this altar? When your people come here and they pray, hear them from heaven. When the windows of heaven are shut, open because they come to this place, this altar, this temple, this place, this place, this place. Church is not a place that you go and fool around and mess around and show yourself. Church is a place where you go to engage the anointing, the covenant, the blessings, the invocation. Those of you who come to church and you not come to this altar, this is your word. Please, hear this one. You don't come to church for somebody. But Solomon said, when you pray in this temple, Is God not everywhere? Yes, God is everywhere. But the kind of problem you have is too much for the place where you are. You need to come to the temple because there's a stronger anointing and covenant here that will speak for you. Lives in a house at a salon down where everybody in the house comes to Royal House Chapel except her. In those days when the church was very small, I used to go around visiting. And that's one house I used to visit. And then when I get there at a salon down, we'll go and be praying. And I am told that when praying, she'll stay in the room, be abusing us and insulting us. And then when I left, she'll come out and say, foolish people, you have nothing doing. You are going from house to house praying and disturbing people. And then she'll fight everybody in the house. 7 years ago, her only son of two, a boy and a girl, the firstborn, 16 years old, was hospitalized. And there was some kind of foreign matter in the marrow of his bone. He is a heavily sickle cell patient, and the thing has eaten into the marrow. And when you get to that portion, they will say it's cancerous, so you are going. The whole of that time, the boy did not go to school. Hospitalized at Kolebu, they draw his blood, test upon test, injections, whatever, medications. Finally, when he had missed the whole term and missed his final exams, they told the mother, Madam Gloria, I think we have done enough. So take your son and go and continue the medication and pray and believe God. So the taxi that was taking them, or whether her private car, which was taking them, they were passing from Kolebu through here. Then when she got there, she screamed to the driver. I said, driver, stop. Go into that compound. Everybody from my house goes to that church except me. Let me go there and see what happens there. So when she came, she sat at the back. And as usual, Royal House Chapel, the anointing, oh my God, the presence, oh Jesus Christ. 3 days are your confirmation that God is with you. When you go to church, when you are in worship and prayer, and then when you are sacrificing, they are confirmations that God is working for you. That's why people discourage you from going to church. That's why people discourage you from praying. That's why people discourage you from worshiping. That's why people discourage you from giving. These are the things that bring you the presence of God. Believe me. And when Samuel took the lamb and began to sacrifice, the Spirit of the Lord came down and the Lord thundered in the camp of the Philistines and destroyed them. The sacrifice brought the presence of God. And when Jehoshaphat was attacked by 3 kings, and then he said, Lord, what shall I do? All he did was he raised a choir. And as they began to worship, the Lord brought confusion into the camp of the enemy. They killed themselves. Worship, praise. The other one, sacrifice. Solomon, what was it that brought the presence of God? He brought the presence of God was the sacrifices and the worship. They could not preach. And then he prayed. He said, God, we make a covenant with you that anytime people step in this temple and they pray, whatever sins they have committed, forget it and hear them. That was a daring covenant. When they have sinned, cancel their sins because of the altar. The anointing was so strong, then I saw coming out crying. So she came to the altar and said, I can never forget. He said, Rev, I'm losing my son. I said, which of us? Said, my firstborn. He's dying. I said, ah, but why haven't you told us? So where is he? He said, he's at the back. We are coming from Kolebu. Then when we got here, I decided I will not go. I'm just coming to church. I said, bring him. Oh, church, when I saw the boy, I wept. Put him on this same altar, where I am standing, this same altar. Then I said, death, live, life, come. I cancel the power of death. You will not die. Bring me the anointing oil. Boom, boom. Carry him away. Ladies and gentlemen, he has finished university. He's a graduate. He's working right now. Give Jesus the glory. Give him a shout of praise. Deacon Auntie Maggie's daughter was going to Kolebu to deliver. And the doctors were kind of predicting cesarean because it was a heavy pregnancy. So on the way, when they got here, then she said to the driver, stop. I want to go and engage the altar before. So this pregnant woman, they carry her with all the weight. Then she came to this altar. I said, Lord, I must tell you the truth. I am afraid of this cesarean. Because I've heard of a cesarean, people go and they don't come. So the thing is that, Lord, I'm afraid. But Lord, there's nothing I can do. Let this altar go with me. Let the presence go with me. Nobody prayed for him. She herself came to this altar, heavily pregnant. When she went, the doctors check. They said, it looks like you can have a normal delivery. Ladies and gentlemen, by the evening time, she had a normal delivery. Are you clapping or you are doing something like clapping? On the 23rd. 23rd is a dangerous number. It's a Friday in June. There is going to be an all night over here. Don't stay away. It's going to be an all night for all our students. Get all the students who have written exams that we are coming. You have written the exams, but it is now time to wage a warfare in the realms of the spirit so that God will give us good markers to mark our papers and so that our results will never be exchanged for another person's results. University students, graduates, SHS, we want this place to be filled. 23rd, Sunday, Friday coming, Friday's week. We have started the Armageddon and we are praying throughout. This week, I want you to report yourself. Because precisely the fact that your prayer and your worship is an indication that God is with you. That's why the devil discourages you from praying and worshiping. Coming to church is not easy for some people. And it's intentional. The devil intentionally does that. Because that's where God shows up for you. He doesn't want you. I knew a certain woman who was barren for 10 years. 10 years. And I came to this altar and said to God, God, 10 years. I have heard about the potency of this altar where the man of God stands. If you give me a child, I'll come back and give to you 10,000. 1,000 for each year that the devil embarrassed me. That same month, she got pregnant. She had a son. She came and she handed over the 10,000 to me. I said, because you have been faithful, God will give you another child. This altar. Young man like you, you've been here for 5 years, 7 years. The songs you can sing in this church are only two. And the devil has cut off your worship because your worship is what brings down the presence of God with you. If I raise this song here, there'll be a fight here. And we exclaim, our God is mighty. We lift up your name, for you are holy. We sing it again, all honor and glory. In adoration, we bow before your throne. And we exclaim. So, some of you, sometimes you tell me, oh, Pastor, I'm singing the song in my head. How can you sing exclamation song in your head?
We lift up your name,
And we ask.
Our God is mighty.
We lift up your name. For you are holy.
For you are holy.
We're singing again.
We're singing again. All honor and glory.
In adoration.
We bow before your throne.
I sang this song one day, and the presence of the Lord came 30 minutes. I see thee. Thy sanctuary. This is the song that made the ICGC. 30 years ago, the worship leader was Reverend Eric Kwapong. This song, if they raise it at ICGC, at Baden Powell, oh my God. This song, at that time, most of you were not born. I mean, have you looked at the words we are singing? I see thee in thy sanctuary. I see thy power and thy glory. Thou art high and lifted up, exalted in thy holy place. I worship you. Sing this song without crying. You can't sing this song without feeling the presence of God. For thou art high and lifted up, exalted in thy holy place. Somebody shout and say, up your voice and your soul and your spirit. Hallelujah.
I worship you.
That Jesus that is higher than you. For thou.
For thou.
Tell him he's exalted.
And lifted up.
Exalted in thy
home.
Sanctuary. Thou art lifted up. Whether you decide to lift him up or not, he's already lifted. And so, it's a privilege and honor to join the angels who have lifted him so that you'll be counted amongst them. He's already lifted. And then I was looking at the word that high. He's higher than you in wisdom. He's higher than you in glory. And then the word that moved me, exalted in this place. Exalted. I was alone in that building. Oh, I cried like a baby. I see thee in thy sanctuary. I see thy power and
thy glory. Thou art high and lifted up.
You better learn it. 30 years ago, we are reviving the song. I see thee in thy sanctuary. I see thy power and thy glory. Thou art high and lifted up, exalted in thy home. Somebody say, I worship you.
I worship you.
Shout it and scream it again. We'll lift up his holy name.
I worship you.
thou art high.
For thou art high.
Here's the conclusion. Know who is around you. Know who is working for you. Know who is fighting for you. Know what is in your mouth. And above all, know what you are carrying. And from today, you don't allow any situation, any demon, any devil to intimidate you, cow you, put fear in your heart, and make you feel like you have nothing. If God be for us, who can be against us? If God be for you, who can be against you? That's the message I want you to carry along. Go and disarm the enemies. Whatever they have that makes them so proud and arrogant, may the Lord transfer it to us. If it is money, we take it from them. Say amen.
Amen.
Don't be afraid of examination again. Don't be afraid of any subject again.
Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world.
It is our fervent prayer that this message will have an effect on your life and will lift you to the place where you belong. For an additional copy of this and any other life-changing CD, please look up the address on your CD. Royalhouse Chapel International, touching our generation with the power of God. God richly bless you.
Ancient words will guide.